Good morning.
Good morning.
Lord have mercy. So, Miss Sue and Cole wanted to invite y'all over for a bowl of Nutra. Yeah. Y'all seen that thing? Y'all seen Cole holding that Nutri-Red out there on that Facebook thing? That was hilarious to me. I'm going to get that blown up. I'm going to put that on the church screen first. He's out there all dressed up like Daniel Boone, and I was trying to picture in my head Jackie and Miss Sue out there holding that Nutri-skinning it and everything to make them some A-do face. So anyway, y'all been worried about groceries and stuff. They got it over there now. Praise the Lord. For all those, look, we're so glad y'all was able to come to that shrimp corn soup. Miss Sandra, she wasn't able to come, and her husband forgot to bring it to her. And I don't know about this, but I told her I was going to get him now. Jason remembered for Janet over there. But we had a really good time. I want to thank all y'all for being there. And I know it's been such bad weather and stuff, and there's been so many flus. I want to tell you, like at the nursing home, they have severe flu going through there. So I'm just going to recommend to you right off the bat that, you know, I believe in going to the nursing home, but it's bad. It's real bad. There's three kinds of flus going around, right? And one of them's a swine flu, and there's a type A flu, and there's another flu going around, and only 10% of that flu shot is working. So take that in consideration. Also today, someone told me, they said, well, we won't even have 50 in church today. Well, we had 76 in Sunday school today. So we're praising the Lord for that. Where's Angie at? Where you at, Angie? Is Angie here? Angie, how many you have up in there?
Well, I always count you in my class, and I had 8
this morning. So Miss Angie had 8 over there. So that's just wonderful. That's a class, some consistency. She usually runs, you know, just like, you know, we'll usually have one in there and stuff. So here it is. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad of that. Tonight, we will not have services tonight. All right? I got remembered, Mike. So we won't have services tonight. It's going to be below freezing well before service time. So these little bridges and overpasses and stuff will ice over. So anyway, so I hope we don't inconvenience you. Also, we're still taking up our Lottie Moon. If you don't know what Lottie Moon is, that is our Christmas offering. 100% of that goes to missions. 100% of that goes to foreign missions to spread the love of Jesus Christ to this world. When you see everything that you're seeing going on, and I know you're getting all frustrated watching the news and stuff, here's what you need to remember. The hope is in nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. The only hope the world has is for the body of Christ to show them the difference. Brother Ellis is preaching at another church today. I can't remember which one it was. Anybody remember which one he's at?
He's at Galilee.
He's at Galilee. In Gloucester. So Brother Ellis is preaching at Galilee in Gloucester. Also, I want you to remember, I went blank right there. Oh, Brother Zach. So Brother Zach is, he's had a biopsy on his kidney, and they put him on a particular steroid. He gained 10 pounds in like a week of just fluid. And so his kidneys, I don't know what all the diagnosis is, but he's having problems. I want you to lift Brother Zach up to you and his entire family during this time. Also, we have a lot of people that aren't here that has been sick. There's a lot of people who have been going through a lot of issues. Also, our little one, the baby, the Felicity. All right, y'all know Felicity? It's Sullivan, right?
Ballard.
I'm wrong. All right, so Felicity Ballard. All right, so she's 9 years old, and I know the majority of y'all know her, and she has a mass on her ovary, all right?
Nope. Jessica.
Well, talked to Scarlett right before I came into church, and she said that the radiologist came in and said, no, there's not a mass, that she had had surgery previously, and it was a calcification from her previous procedure, and so there will be no surgery, there's no mass, there's no cancer, there's nothing.
Praise the Lord.
No.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
I'm telling you, and I believe something was there, and I believe it's gone, is what I believe.
Amen.
That's the way I believe, and I've seen that happen multiple times through the years. I've even right before surgery. So I just praise Jesus that has been a major concern. Also, I want you to remember Miss Teresa Clayton, and of course Dale Floyd. All these have her sister passed away. I want you to remember all those at their time of loss right now, and all those others who have lost people throughout this year as they go through these holidays. Just lift them up in prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Anything else?
It's Tippy Grace's birthday today. It's
Tippy. How old are you, Tippy? Huh? She's 13 years old, right? Stand up so they can see you in case they can't see you in the background. Stand up. Turn around. Turn around. Why are you waving? She's 13. Can any of you remember 13? I can't even remember 13. Happy birthday, my baby. Anything else? All right. God bless you. I hope you have a fabulous New Year. God is going to do great things. Be in prayer because He is still moving. He's still saving, and He's still helping.
Father, we just thank you, Lord, for all the blessings, the grace, the mercy that you show us, Father. We just thank you for the season we rejoice in your birth, Father. And we just ask you to be with us as we begin a new year, Lord, that we would continue to serve you, Lord, and do your will in our lives. Lord, that we would always keep you first in all things. Lord, we just ask you to be with us as we have service this morning, Lord, to bless your heart, to call, cry out and give glory to you, Lord. We just ask you to be with us as we have service, and then we'd all be done pleasing in your sight. We ask you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. 564, make me a channel of blessing. Thank you. soul is Jesus, number 429. Be an offertory hymn. I'll ask you to stand with us again as we sing. Opportunity to come to your house this morning to worship you. Lord, I thank you for the blessings that you have given us this past week, for keeping us safe from harm and danger, Lord. Just allowing us to worship you this morning. We thank you for each one that's here. We pray, Lord, that we'll receive a great blessing from having come this way this morning. I ask you, Lord, now to bless this time of our service. Be blessed the gift and the giver. For these things I ask in your name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
right. Miss Leslie's going to come at this time and do a special for us. She was a little late getting here, and I was wondering if she had forgot about it. I called her the first part of the week, but she is ready to sing for us.
Mary, didn't you know your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered, he will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hands? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss the little baby, you kiss the face of God. You will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great
favorite songs. It's one of them questions you can always ponder. You know, Mary, did you know, is more than just a Christmas song, because the question is, what about you? What do you know about Jesus Christ? You know, a lot of times in this world today, we're facing these situations where people lose hope and they lose focus on what really matters. And throughout all the holidays, I'm going to tell you, the most important decision that you'll make is that you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. If you'll open your Bibles up to Romans chapter 15, verse 7, we're going to read verses 7 through 13. And I want to talk to you about three great words for this coming year that God gives us. Romans chapter 15, we'll start with verse 7, we'll read through verse 13. If you can stand with me as we read God's holy word this morning. So here's your challenge. It says, therefore, accept one another, just as Christ also accepted us, to the glory of God. For I say that Christ has become a servant to the circumcision on behalf of the truth of God, to confirm the promises given to the fathers. And for the Gentiles to glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, therefore, I will give praise to you among the Gentiles, and I will sing to your name. Again, he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. Again, Isaiah says, there shall come the root of Jesse, and he who arises to rule over the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles hope. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Father, I thank you so much for your word today. I thank you so much, God, that as we lift our praises and rejoice in you, Father, it's more than just having a sing-a-thon. That, Lord, it's about truly praising the risen Savior. It's truly praising, Father, that you came to this old hopeless world to bring hope and joy and peace. I pray, Father, that your Spirit will stir our hearts, that all those who've been able to come today, Lord, will feel the peace and security that only you can bring. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. You know, this is that time of year where people start making all those New Year resolutions. Anybody hear about those New Year resolutions? Some of you already been thinking about it. Some of you out there kind of already negative about it. People, they start thinking, because what they think is, well, you know, everybody's going to break them anyway, right? Some of you have already told some people some of the different resolutions that you're going to make about this year. And some people, they may have spoken, may have not, said, nah, you're not going to do that. In your heart, you start thinking all these negative things. And I think sometimes that's a result because we start thinking negative about this world because we feel hopeless. We feel like everything in this world is in so much despair. There's so much troubles. There's so much tribulations that there can't be no hope. So what we see here in the Word is something that's totally different. See, what you have to realize is that Satan's trying to plant despair in your life. He's trying to make you feel hopeless. He's trying to make you feel like there's no way that anything's ever going to get better and that anything's ever going to change in your life, that the situation you're in, that you're in right now is just one of those times that's going to keep you trapped. But God brings a word to us. He brings the word to you so that you can grab hold of it. As a born-again believer, God is the one who gives us the hope. He's the one who changes us. See, because if you're not careful, what happens is you start getting pessimistic and you start having all this cynicism about what the future is going to be. And all you see is negativity. See, this scripture right here, it paints a picture for us of our God. He has high hopes for us. He sees me in the situation that I'm in, and he can see so much better future. The question is, can you see a better future? You see, if you grab hold of what the scripture says and what God wants for you in your life, that you can get past the holdums of these mully drugs where you just feel so hopeless. God sees you, and he sees past wherever you're at, and he sees such a bright future for you. See, the God of hope, in verse 13 right there, he says, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So the God of hope, he declares that we can abound in hope. That's something that ought to be encouraging to you. That's something that ought to place a smile on your face. See, the Bible talks over and over, repeatedly, that we can abound in hope and have so much more. See, Satan is telling you the opposite right now. Satan's trying to tell you that where you're at, it's always going to be this way. God has a hope for us, and he's not in despair about the situation that we're in. He's not in despair about your future. He's not in despair about what Satan's tell you because he says it can be different. He wants you to face it in no matter what you're looking at in the hope of knowing, I know who loves me. I know who cares about my circumstances. I know who knows where I'm at today. Look, hope is something that should fill you with excitement. As a child of God, no matter where you're at, no matter what's going on in your life, no matter the circumstances that you're at, you have to understand the God of all creation knows you by name and what you're going through, and he has a plan for you if you will grab hold of that plan. You see, as Christians, we're able to rejoice in the hope that God has, that glory of God. It says in Romans chapter 5, verse 2. Look at what this says. Romans chapter 5, verse 2. It says, through whom also we have obtained our introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we exult in hope of the glory of God. You see, that's one of the things that kind of we all ought to see right here. God is wanting us to rejoice in that. And one of the things, we come in here and we start praising and singing the words, you got to get past the words and understand that you're worshiping the God of all creation. That even as we're going into the year 2018, no matter what you thought, the terrible things that Satan's threatened you with, you need to see that the God of all creation knows you, and you can exalt him. You can praise him. You can say, thank you, Jesus. I know that you're with me. He speaks about the rejoicing in that hope. It says in Romans chapter 12, verse 12, look what it says. Rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation. In other words, the troubles that you're in right now and devoted to prayer. He said right there, rejoicing in the hope that no matter the circumstances that I'm at today, no matter what kind of situation that I see, I know that the blessed hope is going to get me through this. And you go to seek him in the prayer. You start praying and you get it on your knees. One of the biggest problems in our society today is we spend so much time on the Facebook that we don't spend enough time on our knees seeking the one who is over it all. The one who makes a plan for our lives. The one who created everything. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13, it says, but now faith, hope, love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. But think, the greatest is love, but now faith and hope and love. So where's your hope at? Hope is one of the greatest characteristics that endures. You see, when people lose hope, they start going down. When you lose hope in the future, when you lose hope in your life, when you lose hope in the Messiah, that what you see is this world, and all you listen to is the news reports, then you start getting down, don't you? You start feeling like everything is so hopeless. You look at America, we say, well, it's hopeless. We look at the world, we say, it's hopeless. No, it's not, because Jesus Christ, he's over it all. Hope produces something into our lives. You wonder why you're suffering from a lack of patience. It's because you got no hope. I want you to listen to me. You wonder why you can't be persistent in your life. It's because you got no hope. You give up. You give up and you drop out and say there's no use. Without hope, there's just a little chance of developing patience in your life. People say, I ain't gonna pray for patience because, you know, that brings troubles. Let me tell you, troubles is coming your way. It's whether you have the hope of Jesus Christ that you get past all the things that's gonna happen. Things are gonna happen. Someone says, well, I don't need to hear this for New Year's. Yes, you do, because if you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, you're not going to have the hope, and you're not going to have the patience. Hope helps us face the future. Why should you have hope? When you're looking into this world today, hope is a product of the promises of God that he's given to each and every single one of us. It's more than, listen, you got to get past me as a fat preacher, and you got to get the word right here. He's made promises to you, and he says, I love you. I'll never forsake you. I'll never leave you by yourself. I knew you before you was formed in your mother's womb. He knew you before anyone else. Hope is that product of the presence of God in my life. Now, can you imagine? It says, we're two or more gathered to God be in our presence, right? Now, here's what I want you to think about. When you came to church today, you knew you was going to see Cousin Billy Bob and all these different ones in your life, all these relatives and friends and different ones maybe you've met, maybe you haven't met. But did you think you were going to come and meet with the God of all creation who inhabits the praise of his people and come and speak with him? Did you think you were going to come to a place where your life can be transformed, not by no preachers, not by the music, but by the one that we're praising, the Messiah? You see, that's the product. When I have my hope because I know that he's with me, and no matter what the circumstances are, I know that God is with me and understands what I'm going through. I know that he cares about what's taking place in my life. You see, hope is a product of the power of the Lord that works within us. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, for it's God who is at work in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Here's one of the big problems today. You see, we quit working for the pleasure of God, and we work for whose pleasure? Now, it wouldn't be none of you. This would be for those people you need to go out and witness to. It's not going to be no problems that you are. Y'all hear me? Can you hear me, Charlie? Okay, I want to make sure because I ain't hearing much back here. You see, a lot of times we work for who? Just ourselves. So we spend so much time working for ourselves that we forget that we work for the good pleasure of the God of all creation. That we work for his word to be spread. We work because he's called us out of darkness. We work because he allows us to work. You've been called. the God of us, the God of hope. What he does is he desires to come into your life, and he wants to give you joy. Now, joy is something right here. See, it's so important to you to see that scripture. See, that the hope that God might fill us with, it says all joy. Well, that's something right here. See, joy is such an elusive, misunderstood term. The concept of joy, we get it all confused. It's mistaken with happiness. You see, happiness is linked to what happens to you and to those that you love. So joy is so much deeper than that. Joy is more than that, because you might be going through trials and tribulations, and somebody you love might be going through. Can you imagine your 9-year-old child be facing surgery and all that? See, you can clap your hands when you hear that, you know what, she's not going to have surgery now. But let me ask you, was you willing to clap your hands before that? It's kind of hard. It's hard for us to get this, because joy is more than what it's your understanding is. See, joy and pleasure, what we do is we kind of mix them together. We try to make a gumbo. And pleasure is that pause between the experiences, between two pains. Pleasure is when, you know, I went through this trouble and I come out of it and I feel good now. And so I have that kind of happiness. And then later on, there's going to be some more pain in my life. But Christian joy is so much deeper. It's not dependent upon the circumstances that I'm in. It's not dependent upon whether I'm just healthy. It's not dependent upon if I'm rich. It's not dependent upon if I'm at the location that pleases me. It's not dependent upon that I have all my toys. See, joy is thankfulness for the God who is God of all. And because of what he's done for me through the death of his only begotten son, the joy of knowing, no matter where I'm at, no matter what's going on, that I'm never alone. The joy of knowing that the God of creation called me out of darkness. The joy of knowing that my future destiny has been changed by the blood of Jesus Christ. The joy of knowing that his promises never fall short. See, God wants to fill us with that joy and understanding the concept of forgiveness. Some people are here today and they're under bondage because they can't forgive somebody. Might be somebody here, might be somebody else. Yeah, don't you think, grab hold of this. People have had things happen to them. People have had troubles, trials, hurts, disappointments. But the situation, where you're at, is whether you're willing to let go and let God. It's so easy to be unforgiving. It's so easy to say, you know what, they did you wrong. And here's the thing. You know they did you wrong. And God knows they did you wrong. But did they do Jesus Christ wrong? When they nailed him to the cross of Calvary, when they beat him, when they spit upon him, you know, the one who is guilty of nothing, who has no sin in his life, who had never done anything wrong ever, never spoken anything wrong, and they did all that to him. And what did he do when he was hanging up on the cross? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And you think about our lives, and so many times, because it's so flesh, and we say, my goodness, I just can't forgive them. Now here, this sounds rough. Forgive them, lest ye be forgiven. It's hard, ain't it? I ain't telling you it's easy, but I'm telling you something. When you can discover what it means in the Word, it sets us free, and you can really achieve joy. Because God, with everything in your life, and you may not think you're too bad. You may say, well, I never was a wild child. You were lost and sinful and dying and going to hell. You were at one time in your life, listen to me, I made somebody mad one time when I spoke this, the enemy of God. I made somebody so mad, they met with me after service. I never was enemy of God. Well, I don't know what Bible you're reading. But you better look back, because when you were lost, you did everything the opposite. You served somebody. And you might have been going to church. You might have had on a suit or a dress. You might have been coming up here and everybody patting you on your little head. You was lost. that Jesus Christ came to you and he called you. And when you made that decision to accept him, he forgave you. He says, forgive me, Father, for I've lost and I'm sinful. You see, you wonder why people struggle with lack of joy? It's because they don't understand the joy of where they're at, even with their relationship with Christ. And they take, when I talk about eternal life, they can't get past where they're at today. The circumstances. They cannot get past whatever's going on and tripping them up and making them stumble. And it's serious. We know it's serious. That's why Christ was willing to shed his blood upon Calvary, because that's how serious it was. And he comes to your life and he says, I want to give you a little joy. Isn't it funny how we push him away and say, I'm not taking that joy. I'm not going to take it. He says, I want to give it to you. It's a gift for you. See, it's whether we'll open up and receive it. He wants to fill us with the joy of being part of something more than who we are. You know, we always talk around here and always joking because all you, it's so funny to me. I find it so hilarious. Every Whittington in here says they ain't kin. That's so hilarious. Listen, that oak tree ain't even got no limbs on it. Some of y'all get that? Everybody that ain't a Whittington sitting over there laughing, and Whittington's going like, we'll get you, we'll vote you out, we control this. Every one of us are kin. You know why? It's through the blood of Jesus. We become the sons and the daughter of God. Don't you think? So you become a prince and a princess. I love, my granddaughter, Tedra, went and she found some, what's that stuff called? What do you call that thing? It's a little dress and all. It was, it's got this movie. Y'all probably haven't heard of this. Frozen. I don't know. They get up, they spin and all this, whatever. I don't know. I'm such a boring person. But anyway, she gets that, and she says, I like to dress up as a princess. See, when you was coming to church today, and no matter what you're wearing, you could have been wearing overalls or anything else. You could be wearing a nice dress, a nice suit or something. Here's the thing. You're a prince and a princess. And the God of all creation is the one who gives you that. Let me tell you something. When you understand that you have a big family, you know what? You know, as a pastor, you pack up and you leave your biological family and you move all over the country and stuff, at least some of them do, and you leave your homeland, you leave where you were born and raised at, and you go all over the place. But here's the thing, you're never alone. You know why? Because God's got a big old family. And that God of all creation brings you into his family and welcomes you. You know, sometimes in our families, we're not too happy when we go to them family reunions. We feel like, oh, no, I'm going to see that tater head again or so-and-so. And you actually try to hide behind, you know, the big oak tree or something and say, because I just don't want to hear that. But everybody in God's family is equal, because they were all saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. And he tells you, welcome home when we enter heaven itself. Christ, he wants to fill us with the joy of knowing that we're going to go to heaven and that this life is so much more. We look at this life and the circumstances and we say, oh my goodness, you know, I'm approaching 100 or whatever. That's nothing. I seen somebody today that was on they was going through a list of the people that had passed away, all these stars and all this kind of stuff, and they were doing their celebration. And I don't know where all their relationship is, but I got to thinking, I said, man, can you imagine, though, when we get to the gates of heaven, you know, that when we enter in, that there's a celebration that goes on, that the angels of heaven and your family and your loved ones meet you at the gate of heaven and you walk in there. Can you imagine what it's going to be like? Let me tell you, because eternity doesn't have a clock. Because preachers, well, at least no one tells me this, by the way, if you're visiting, they don't ever focus on this. I focus more on it. But you look at this clock and you see what time it is, and you start saying, oh my goodness, you know, I need to hurry up and shut up. Can you imagine when you don't understand, you don't have that concept of time anymore, that the celebration just goes on and on and on? You see, that's the kind of joy. That's the kind of joy of understanding what God has done and what he's doing in your life and what he's going to do in your life. He wants to fill you with that joy that comes as a result of being out there as a servant of his and seeing people come to know Christ. Carly, here we go. She ain't no scaredy cat no more. I can call her on anything. She filled up to the brim with the Holy Ghost. I ain't gonna lie. So how many people did you lead to Christ this past year? You got to stand up so they can hear you. Turn around so they can hear you. They can't see you on the back row. Stand up so they can see. Seven or eight? Did that bring any joy in your life when you seen somebody come to Christ? See, when we were up there and she led, I don't know, it was a couple she led to Christ when we were there at that camp. She was bubbling over. She was bubbling over, Lord forbid me, I'm a Baptist, better than any champagne bottle, okay? She was just, this is without the alcohol, this is the other kind, this non-alcohol champagne stuff. She was just bubbling over because of the joy of knowing that she had done what Christ had called her to do, and she made an eternal difference. That's the difference. When you start understanding that and you start serving God and you start seeing people get saved, it changes your whole perspective because you just know that you've done something that will last for how long? Ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Longer than the sun will burn. Longer than the world will exist. Now you think about that. You see, when you're out there and you're planting those seeds, because I know sometimes you get frustrated and you're wondering, like, does it make a difference when I share Christ with so-and-so? They always keep going back or they keep having these struggles. It makes a difference because if they give their life to Christ, oh, what a day. Oh, what a day it is because you know that you've done something that makes an eternal difference. Listen, the God of hope, he fills you with something that changes your perspective because he comes into your life and he brings a peace. It says in that Romans chapter 15, verse 13, it says, all right, we're going to say, okay. Now may that the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace. Now, that's something everybody's looking for. See, people have always sought after, they always want a troubled-free life. No one wants to have difficulties. No one wants to see their children go through difficulties. No one wants to ever experience difficulties. We long for serenity. And that's why you see people going to these foreign religions. And I make people mad with that too because they go over there and they do things that Scripture says. That's not going to change your life, but they see it's the common thing. You know, I don't know if y'all realize this or not, but I'm going to make somebody mad, Tedra. You know I am. You know yoga's a religion. Oh! You didn't know that, did you? Here's what's funny, and I'm not trying to tell somebody these young people they're bad. See, because what they're doing, they watch Facebook and all this kind of stuff. You have people my age that don't understand that there's certain things about Scriptures, and they're looking for, what they're looking for is peace and serenity. And so it can't be wrong if it feels right, can it? Huh. See, that's the difference. Man, we're looking for something that God is offering to us freely. And as a sinner, what we do is so many times in our lives, we have that inner tension that's making serenity impossible. When you're lost without Christ, you don't have the hope, you don't have the peace, you don't have the joy. And we're so distracted by our own personal desires and ambitions that are contradictory to what God says in the Word. There's this civil war. There's a Jekyll and a Hyde that's always trying to get out of us. Our mind and heart become this major battleground. And Satan's coming in there. And we our personalities being split. And God wants to come into your life of chaos, and he wants to bring that order to your life. He wants to bring order in the midst of the chaos to mankind. He wants to bring the tranquility where the turmoil ends. But we live in this dangerous world, don't we? They all across the news are saying, we're closer to nuclear war than we've been, and you know, people are going through, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Let me tell you something, what you need to do, you need to get your life right with Christ, because the day the missile goes off, who cares? Because this is going to sound strange to some of you. Have peace of knowing that no matter where I'm at, the God of all creations, knows where I'm at. And I will not die one day before I'm scheduled to. Is that strange to you? That's why when you study and you see these preachers that fought like in some of these different wars, and one used to stand up and as Stonewall Jackson, he was a preacher, and he was out there, he would stand up in the midst of all the cannon fire and all the rifle fire, and they said, "How can you do this?" He says, "Because I know I won't go one moment before God desires me." See, we're distracted so much in our lives by the things of the world that we don't receive the message of Christ and the promises. We need to be comforted. You need someone to comfort you, like when you was a child and you would run a fever and you were upset and you were in turmoil and you didn't know which way to go, and you'd go to your mother and you'd say, "Mama, I don't know what to do." And she'd wrap her arms around you and she'd love on you and she'd wrap you up real tight and rock you. See, God comes into our lives and he gives us that comfort. He helps us to seek good. He brings out of us everything that should be brought out for a life that's pleasurable. In Romans 8, chapter 28, this is what it says. "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God." Now, let's go back. "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God," to those who are called according to whose purpose? His purpose. You see, when you understand this word of God, it becomes more than just coming to a church service, more than just singing some little, you know, little campfire songs or something like that. When it changes your life, see, the Holy Spirit who indwells every single one of us at the moment of conversion, he fills our cup to overflowing. What he does is he seeks to continually bring us into harmony with the will of God. You're wondering why you're in turmoil? Maybe you're out of harmony. The Holy Spirit's trying to get your attention, and he's trying to get you. And you've been going to church for years, whatever, may have been raised in a church all the time. Here's the thing. The only thing that's going to make a difference in your life is when you respond to the Holy Spirit and go to where God wants you to be at. See, that's the only thing that makes inner peace possible. Otherwise, you're always wondering the same thing. And all of us can do this as if we're not careful, we start to wonder why. Right? We wonder why. But then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit reminds us, all of it's going to work out for the glory of God if you love God. So the text, it tells us through the power of the Holy Spirit that the life of hope, this life of joy, this life of peace is only made possible with that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. See, the power of the Holy Spirit and the blessings from God come to us through believing and trusting. I know he has a plan. I know he has a purpose. I know I'm not forgotten. I know I'm not by myself. I know that the goodness and graciousness that I've experienced in my life have all come from God. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. "And without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him." Let me tell you, we seek a lot of things in life. We seek and we chase after a lot of stuff, and you know, that's wonderful. But if you wonder why you don't have the peace, if you wonder why you're always at war, if you're wondering why you're always at battle, if you're wondering what the tribulation is, it ain't just because of your family heritage. It ain't because of your root system. It's because of the relationship with Jesus Christ needs to be a burning fire instead of a spark. I guarantee you, if I come to your fireplace this week and we look into that fire and it's down to about, probably most of you gets down below 85, you're already freezing. So this week you're going to have troubles. You're going to burn some wood and you're going to keep stoking the fire. You're going to keep putting that wood in. How much wood are you putting on your fire today? You want hope and peace and joy for this coming year? Let me tell you something. It's only through Jesus Christ. You can rejoice in the fact when you have that relationship that God wants to give you hope. He wants to give you joy, and he wants to give you peace that passes understanding. It's all for you. It's a special gift that's wrapped up. It's placed under the tree. And all you got to do is say, Lord, that's what I want in my life. These altars are going to be open today as they're coming down to play an altar call song. If you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ, there is not a better time than New Year's Eve to give your life to Jesus Christ and let Him transform you into a new creation. Let Him give you the peace, joy, and hope. Let Him give you what you've been looking for. If maybe you're just having some struggles in your life, you just want to come down here and pray and seek His face. Let me tell you something. He hasn't forgotten you. You're not alone. You're not a less than person because you're going through something. It's just remembering. Sometimes we got to be reminded. We just have to be reminded that He loves you and that you matter. Won't you come this morning as they play?
Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
These altars are open.
Hear my humble cry. While on others Thou art calling, do not pass me by. Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others Thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at Thy throne of mercy find a sweet relief, kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. Thou art calling, do not pass me by. Trusting only in His merit, would I seek Thy face. Heal my wounded, broken spirit. Save me by Thy grace. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others Thou art calling, do not pass me by. Oh, the spring of all my comfort, more than life to me. Whom have I on earth beside Thee? Whom in heaven but Thee? Thou art calling, do not pass me by.
Sir, be no Bible study Thursday night. No Bible study Thursday night. We won't have services tonight, y'all. So y'all stay safe and blessed in the name of Jesus. Brother Raymond, call on somebody to pray, please.
let's stand together as we're dismissed. Brother Al, would you dismiss us?
Thank you.